It's so good to see you. It's so good to see you.
Good to see you as well. Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you.
Me too. I am
such
so
a pleasure.
Happy.
Pleasure to have you on our show. Well, welcome everyone. Welcome to another Astral Interview. And with me, I have Michelle Pascal. So before we talk to Michelle, I met Michelle through Sarah Troy, our dear Sarah. And she told me a little bit about Michelle, not very much. There's lots to know though, because he's a transformational spiritual teacher. He's an artist. He's a meditation teacher. He's a singer. I mean, there's so much. He's made a movie. And so what I'd like to start with is just your life. Tell us a little bit about you and where you grew up. Just a little bit about your past.
I have an amazing chance because I was born in a family in France, in Paris, in a family very violent. So
wow.
It was a chance for me because I love to spend time in a church. There is a church close my home.
Right.
And when I was so young, I was a kid, I realized that there is no life without peace.
Right.
There is no life without peace. So
right.
I grew up in a very violent...
So young. How does someone so young come to the understanding of the importance of peace?
We understand peace when we live in a violent family. So this is a chance.
Yes.
Because you have immediately the contrast. I was at home.
Yeah.
I was scared. I was crying. It was a lot of violence every day. So when I arrived in the church, I was in heaven. I was in peace. So naturally, I felt that there is no life without peace. And after I started to sing in a church, and I spent a lot of time in church, and I became professional singer, as we say in France, at 16. And I start to sing on stage many times. And I came also to New York after to sing with a jazzman musician, incredible jazzman musician. And when I was so young, I start also to edit some little film. I have a Super 8 projector, you know. And I love to cut the little film of Charlie Chaplin, Buster Keaton. And I start to edit, I start to direct film. And I wrote all the time poetry. I wrote all the time songs, and I make music all the time. So today I have the same life. I direct a film, I teach meditation, I write song, I sing on stage, I mean. And
You've written so many books as well.
Yes, I have published 20 books.
Wow.
And I prepare a new book also. So the fact to live in a violent family was a blessing because, you know, we progress only when life is difficult. So we don't progress when life is easy. We make progress when our life is difficult. So our challenge are our spiritual teachers. So
right.
When we grow up in a violent family, and we develop also an amazing compassion. After, we must forgive to our parents. We must love them. They are in the sky. I love them. I pray for them. But
yes,
I think we cannot help people in the suffering if we have not improved the suffering.
Right.
And it's very interesting because when I was so young, I realized I didn't know what means meditation, but I understood something when we are in a violent situation, when there is pressure, we cannot quiet our mind by ourselves.
Right.
It was an evidence for me when I was a child. And my question after, when I became teenager, when I became adult, when I discovered spirituality, my mm-hmm. question all time was, how can we calm the mind when we are unable to calm the mind?
Right.
We cannot. Right. If we live in a violent family, we cannot. Right. When we have the trauma after, we cannot. When our life has a lot of pressure, we cannot. So naturally, I create.
Did the church introduce you to the meditation, or how did you come to learning about meditation?
The thing is, I love the church, and after I discovered Buddhism, and Buddhism was a revelation for me. And after I met my Rinpoche, Chepa Dorje Rinpoche, I was a disciple of Chepa Dorje during 15 years. And he passed away, but he's in your show today. He's very present in my heart.
Of course, of course.
So, but my question was, how to meditate when we cannot meditate?
Right.
Because I was in this case. So from this question came the answer to develop an approach of meditation, especially first for me to survive. And after I say, maybe it can help other people who are in a challenging life.
A similar situation.
I became, for example, I direct the meditation program for the prisoners of Los Angeles at Amity Foundation. And mm-hmm. since 5 years, 6 years. So for example, prisoners, they cannot meditate by themselves. And after I start to work with the firemen of New York, with doctors are too much stress. The brain is running all time. They cannot make an effort to meditate. So my question was, how can we meditate when we cannot meditate?
Right, right.
How is it possible? And from that, I start to create meditation for daily stress, an approach of meditation for people who cannot make an effort. You know, when we say make an effort, be focused on your breath, etc., it's so beautiful. Of course, we need to do that. But me, I was unable to do that. You know, when I was a child, I didn't know meditation, but when you are a child and you cry under your bed, you cannot take a deep breath. It doesn't work.
Right.
So when I came in the church, suddenly when I was a child, I was tuned by the vibration of the church. You know, you are at home, there is violence, you shake, you arrive in a church, poof, you don't shake. You are happy because you are tuned by the vibration. I say vibration because you are a specialist of vibration and energy.
Yes.
And we see a beautiful cosmos around you. You are a cosmos. So I realize that we need to be guided. We need to be tuned by a calming vibration. And so this new way of meditation starts from my own experience, because I was unable to be focused on my breath. I must be tuned. So when I guide meditation...
Michelle, I should clarify, though, I am not a specialist of vibration. I'm still a student of vibration. And
we are all
students. Learning.
All students. It's good. It's a good answer. Everyone, we are a student. Everyone. Yeah. It's funny what you say. I say all the time to the prisoners, I am not your meditation teacher. You are not my student. There is an exchange of energy.
Yeah. Of course.
There is not the teacher and the disciple. No, we exchange our energy.
Yes, that's right.
So to reply to your question, to finish and to be precise, it was a fact that I realized that in my case, I don't say for everyone, it was my experience, I was unable to meditate. I need to be tuned, I need to be guided with a calming frequency, by a calming presence. in a church, there is a calming energy. We are quiet immediately. So when I guide people in meditation, I try to tune their energy on a calming vibration, and I don't give any exercise. And this is like that this approach of meditation was developed so by the prisoners, the firemen of New York, doctors, teachers, many sort of people, engineer at Google in Manhattan. So many sort of people and kids practice this approach of meditation.
So when you say calming vibration, when you say this to somebody, like when I think calming vibration, already there's this sense of calming that comes to me just by saying the word calming sometimes.
Of course. We are what we say. We are what we say. So just when we say the word calmness, calming, immediately the concept, the mental picture of the word, this is what we name in theology, you know, medicine words. It's a medicine word. When we say calmness, calming vibration, but it is not enough. It's not enough. We must be what we say.
Yes.
Especially in spirituality. We cannot teach peace. We cannot guide peace if we are not in peace.
Right.
It cannot work.
So how does one get from the word of calmness to the being of calmness then? What is path?
I love your question, Shiny Rose. It's a beautiful question. You put the finger immediately on the heart. Again, for me, just my experience, but meditation, it's more than a technique. It's a transmission of energy.
Right.
So as a teacher, we must be what we say. We must have a stable life. We must be calm. We must be happy. Every day, we must be positive because we cannot lie to someone who suffers. When you are facing a prisoner who suffers a lot, we cannot be fake. He feels immediately. You know, prisoners, they have an incredible intuition. Like I teach for police officers, they have also an amazing intuition.
Right.
So the person feels immediately our energy, our calming energy. Right. So immediately the person, there's release, tension.
Yes.
And the hoof, for me, this is a miracle. At the moment we say, we release, you know, we create a sort of addiction. It's a neurochemical addiction because we know in neuroscience, all the studies since 30 years prove that when we calm the mind, we have more serotonin and we become addicted day by day to the serotonin.
Right.
So
right.
After, we can be in a stressful environment, but we don't react the same that if we are very stressed. We can be addicted to the stress, but we can be addicted to the peace.
Yes.
So this is like that the hoof, this is the beginning of a miracle. This is the awakening. And yes. I will say, especially...
That expression alone is a form of breathing, yes?
Of course, yes. Of course. And especially in the stressful situation. I go to New York in 1 hour. I take plane, I go to New York to give a retreat in Times Square. In the middle of the stressful situation, I give retreat for my friend, firemen, and other people. And we will be quiet in the middle of Times Square in New York.
Wow.
When you touch your soul in Times Square, when you feel the peace in the middle of the storm.
Yeah.
It's an unforgettable experience. And like that after, this is like the song of Frank Sinatra. If you can make it in New York, you can make it anywhere.
Right. Right. Wow. Okay, so then tell us, for those listening and wondering, how do they get there? You say it's not an exercise, and it's not necessarily steps to get there. Then how does one get there?
Let's make one meditation together in 1 minute.
Sure. I'd love to.
Let's do together 1 minute.
Sure.
Simple. No cushion, nothing, just we are together. And I will snap just like that to close our eyes. And I will snap to open our eyes. Very simple. Okay. I snap 3 times. And just we close our eyes. We are sitting down in a comfortable position, like a mountain. And we visualize a mountain, a huge mountain. We see the stability of the mountain. We breathe in mentally the stability of the mountain. Keep our breath, keep stability in our mind, exhale stability. And immediately, we feel the stability of the mountain in our body. When we meditate like a mountain, we become a mountain. And we open our eyes.
Beautiful.
How do you feel, my friend?
Beautiful. Beautiful. Stable.
This practice of the mountain is very, very ancient. It was a practice in Hesychasm. Hesychasm was the way of meditation of the first hermit in Greece, after the time of Jesus. It's very old. You can find the mountain in the Orthodox tradition, the Orthodox Christianity.
The Greek Orthodox tradition?
Exactly. Yes. So I have adapted to our time. But if you read books about Greek Orthodox, you found Hesychasm, and in Hesychasm, the first practice to be sitting down like a mountain.
Okay.
To be more stable, more grounded. Most of time, we are divided in many, many directions. We are trapped by the temptation of distraction. We need to be more stable. We need to be more present. So the mountain, it's a metaphor, it's a mental picture who structure our brain immediately. In neuroscience, there is a lot of studies. We observe the brain of the person, we put electrode, and we see how react the brain of the person according the photo or the video that you can show to this person. So when we see a mountain or when we visualize a mountain, it's immediately, it structures the brain, it structures the cognitive process, and the neurochemical reaction, of course.
Right. And this is consistent for everyone. Anyone who does a visualization about a mountain will instantly experience the stability of the mountain.
Yes. But after, the most important, I will say it's 5% visualization and 95% when we guide the person, the vibration, the transmission of the energy. Because, of course, the mountain creates a cognitive process. But in the same time, if I am stressed, if my mind is running all the time and I guide this meditation, it doesn't work. So the benefit of a session, this is the calmness of the person who guide the meditation. We have a big responsibility when we teach meditation.
Right, right. And therefore, the person who is giving the guided meditation has to be in that place of oneness and in that zone of heart connection with God, with spirit, with whatever you want to call it.
Yes, I will say we must be in vacuity. When I guide you during 1 minute or when we sing on stage, our mind is empty. Our mind, as a teacher, my mind is like a sky. Just I see the mountain and poof, it's very simple.
So you compared the meditation to the singing.
Yes, it's interesting, you know, in Navajo tradition, to sing means to pray. And in every spirituality, we sing all the time. Yes, and of course, the sacred chanting, this is a way to tune the mind. It was like that when I was in the church as a child, when I listened to chanting. Wow, I say it calmed my
so
mind.
So beautiful.
So you come from your home, your family, violent. You arrive in a church. Oh, I was in ecstasy. I listen some Gregorian chanting, some Aramean chanting. So you are a child. You want to repeat. You want to sing like that. So the church was my school to sing.
And so the church inspired your singing and your motivation to sing and to learn about singing and to perform.
Yes, and it's funny because most of the time I play with black musicians. I am a little white guy, and I sing with my friends. They are black women. Yeah, come on! They are amazing singers. And me, I am the little white guy who sing high. So it's funny. But yes, in a church or in a synagogue or in a mosque or in a mountain, in shamanism, in Navajo tradition, in every spirituality, chanting, this is really the connection to God. Because when we sing, we don't think. We don't think.
So can you talk about the distinction between silent connection to God and the singing connection to God? Can you talk about this distinction? Is there a distinction, or is it both of them will get you to the same place?
Again, I love your question. I really love it. It's rare that I have a good question. Your question is I have many good questions all the time, but these questions are very interesting. First, what means God?
Yes.
In Hebrew, God means Elohim. Elohim means the energy. So God, in the etymology of God, this is not someone who judge us. God means the energy. So all is energy.
Yes.
or talk, or phone, or laptop, all is energy. So yes. To be connected to God means to be connected to the energy. And when we are stressed, we are disconnected. Yes. We cut our relation with our friends, our family. We are a ghost. So the connection with God, this is something beyond all what we can say. God is beyond any belief system. God is beyond any words, any explanation. God, I love your question with the side. I will say that God starts when we enter in silence. And I will say God starts after the silence.
Right.
First, the silence. We stop to talk. No concept, no belief, no mental projection. There is a sort of silence. And after the silence, there is God. There is something that we cannot name, that we cannot explain, that we cannot describe, but right. that we can feel.
Yes.
We feel. I will say faith, it is not a belief. It is an experience.
Yes.
It is an experience.
And it's instantaneous.
There
and it's instantaneous.
Doubt.
It's immediate. It's
yes.
There's no thought between yes, no. There's no this duality. Oh. It's just there, and you just have a knowing immediately, right?
Yes, there is nothing. Suddenly, boom. And yes. When we sing on stage or in a cathedral, or I sing at Carnegie Hall in New York every year,
oh, wow.
Now since 5 years, yes, I am so... Carnegie Hall, for me, it's a cathedral. When we sing at Carnegie Hall, it's an incredible church. So
right.
I sing again this year's Christmas Eve concert at Carnegie Hall. So you
wow.
sing in an incredible cathedral, and when you arrive on stage to sing, you are facing God. I mean, you don't think, you say, I will say, you say, like Saint Francis of Assisi, say, Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. That's it. When there is a thread, let me bring hope. When life is difficult, let me bring joy. Make me an instrument of your peace. That's it. I say that because I have composed the music on this prayer, and I will start the show of Christmas with right. this prayer. Lord,
wow.
make me an instrument of your peace. That's it. We are just an
so
instrument.
So beautiful. So beautiful. There was an incident in my life where a friend was experiencing a time which was very, very sad for her because her husband was passing, and she invited me into the space of this happening, and I asked God, what do I say to her? Like, you know, how do I give solace to somebody who's at, you know, at the feet of her husband who's dying?
Of course.
And God says, tell her to find the peace.
Yes, God means peace.
And so
you know,
with us,
the famous quote of Jesus, huh? Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. The peace of Jesus, it is not a psychological peace. It's a spiritual peace.
Right.
It's a peace who doesn't depend on any situation.
Right.
It's not, and again, we can be in peace in Times Square. We can
right.
be in peace in the train in New York, in the traffic in Los Angeles. Peace, it's like oxygen. It's
right.
everywhere. When we calm the mind, poof, we are in God.
So when, you know, when I think about peace or someone else thinks about peace, their definition of peace, their experience of peace is different.
Of course. But
so,
to be in peace, I will say first, it's a physical sensation.
Right.
I will say, we talk too much about peace. We must be in peace. It was the quote of Saint Thérèse of Lisieux. Many times, yeah. Thérèse, she says, stop to talk about God. Be in God. We can say today, we talk too much about peace, mindfulness. No, no, yeah. Be quiet. But be quiet in the difficulty. If, for example, if you have a conflict, yes. And everyone, we have conflict. There is no life without conflict. Or if we have, if we lose someone that we love, like your friend.
Yes.
It's amazing when we are in the challenge to improve peace, to be calm when it's difficult. This is the awakening. The awakening, it is not to take a lot of drugs and to try to fly in the sky. No, the awakening, it's when you are in a conflict with someone and suddenly you feel peace. You feel God in your heart. This is the awakening.
So beautiful. You know, the simplest of things can take us out of our joy, our happiness sometimes.
Of course.
The simplest of things, you know, and when you're in that simple fear, sadness, whatever, anger, whatever it is, getting back to that peace is, you know, first of all, getting out of what state you're in before you can even get into the peace. There is that disconnect that's there that you need to somehow know the tools to be able to get back.
There is no debate. We must be in peace. And peace, this is the best medication for the best attitude, the best medicine. But my question, me, it's not if we need to be in peace. My question is, how can we be in peace again when we are unable to make an effort?
Yes.
When our life is too much difficult. I create this way of meditation first for me. It was my way to survive. Maybe I will be not talking to you if it doesn't come to me.
Yes.
How can we be quiet in our crazy world when we are unable to take a deep breath? I am unable. It's too much scary. It's too much violent. I cannot. It is the question of my life. And this is the answer of my life.
So I want to ask you another question then. Just by doing the act of breathing or doing this guided meditation, it often becomes rote. Like it becomes like something you're doing, but you're not necessarily experiencing what you are doing. Do you know what I'm trying to say? And so does it become less effective then when at that time when it becomes rote versus when you're actually consciously engaged in this practice?
It is clear that, for example, at Amity Foundation with the prisoners of Los Angeles, we make a survey. Every session, at the end of every session, we make a survey. We ask some questions to each prisoner. To see exactly. You will be surprised, but since 5 years, 100% of the prisoners, they say, we feel calmer, we feel better, we feel more happy, we feel more grateful, we feel more free. This is the 5 keywords that we have at 8 any survey that we make. They say one of these 5 words, or sometimes 3 words, 4. This is the same words who come back all time. And population incarcerated, this is the population the most affected by violence, depression, suicide. This is the population the most affected. So it's incredible to see that this is possible. And of course, these prisoners, they are in the case to be unable to take a deep breath. They cannot calm the mind by themselves. So this is the reason why me and all my teachers certified, now I have around 20, 25 teachers around the world. So when they work with prisoners, they calm the mind immediately, and the prisoner with no effort Release the tension. And become addicted to the release, to the serotonin. This is like that we have this incredible result with the prisoners. We replace the addiction of stress, the cortisol, by the addiction of the peace, the serotonin.
Beautiful. So you've written 20 books.
Yes.
What is the content of these 20 books?
It's 20 books about spirituality. I wrote books about Saint Therese. I wrote book about the Titanic, also the ship, to talk spiritually about the Titanic. I wrote a book about spirituality and money, how spirituality can be integrated in money. I wrote many books, but the last one, it's in English, Meditation for Daily Stress. This is the book to explain the practices.
Wow. So when we talk about spirituality and money, let's go back a little bit. What advice you have for people about spirituality and money?
First, me, I have no advice, and I never give any advice to people. Because I think the only advice that I can give is to don't follow any advice, but to follow your intuition.
Beautiful. Yes.
I never give, I am not here to say, oh, thank you, my friend. I have an answer for, no. I have zero answer. I have zero advice. I have zero tips to give. The only tips that I could give is to don't follow any tip, to follow our intuition. So yes. When we are in a difficult financial situation,
yes,
no tips can help us. But if we calm the mind, by intuition, we can have an idea. We can clarify the situation. Because, for example, imagine we are in the situation we don't know how to pay our lease this month. With the COVID, we lose our job, it's very difficult. What to do? If we are stressed, oh my gosh, there is no solution. If we calm the mind, suddenly we can say, oh, I have an idea. I must create a new business. I must talk to my bank. Maybe they can give me a loan, not too much high. I must talk to my owner and I must say, I'm so sorry, with the COVID, I cannot pay my lease. Can we imagine a plan? I found a solution. There is solution all the time. But when we are stressed, we are unable to find solution. So this is the reason why money problem, it is very painful. And it is in the same time an incredible opportunity to change our life. Maybe to reduce our life, maybe to say, I need to sell my home, I need to live in another place, more cheap, and I will be more happy. I mean, I enter in another quality of happiness because I have less pressure.
Right. Absolutely. So there's a movie, Never Alone.
Yes, I have directed the film. I have a film edited, composed, and direct a film, a fiction, a narrative, with my friend Gabriela Wright, the exceptional actress, and my other friend Deepak Chopra. Deepak.
Wonderful.
It's the first time that Deepak accepts to play in a film. He plays his own character. And this is a film, a positive film about prevention of suicide. So the film will be broadcast probably beginning of next year on one of the big networks that we have in America.
Wonderful. And so how was it working in the film and working with Deepak Chopra and...
Deepak.
And the topic itself.
Yes, I will say to you, I have no words to talk about Deepak. I have no words to talk about his kindness, his humility, his calm, his incredible intelligence. And many times when I was filming him, I was crying. And just at the end, I say, Deepak, I love you. That's it. When I was at Carnegie Hall last time, he came with me on stage with Michael Beckwith. Michael Beckwith is also in the film. And when we sing on stage, I remember I sing, and at the end, I have in my hand the hand of Deepak, and in the other hand, the hand of Michael. I was crying because suddenly Michael is also an angel. He's so kind, so kind. He's an incredible angel. And Temple Hayes, also the famous reverend woman in Florida, Temple Hayes, she came back also at Carnegie Hall with me at Christmas Eve, and she will be also this year at Carnegie Hall with me. So it's amazing. In America, we are blessed to have spiritual leaders like that. So I have no words to talk about Deepak.
You'll have to allow me to interview all of you about this film so that I can get all your points of view.
We will see. Maybe, inshallah. Inshallah, all is possible. We will see. We keep in touch, and you have my app, Mind Dive app. Yes. And everyone can contact me on Instagram. Michelle Meditates on Instagram.
Yes.
Or on Facebook, on my page, Michelle Pascal. Yes. Every day, I take a time.
It's a great pleasure to meet you.
Reply to everyone. I take a time to reply to everyone. It's also a spiritual practice for me to take this time to everyone.
Thank you. I will share your contact information. It was a very great pleasure to meet you.
Thank you. And where are you in America? Which city you
are? I'm not in America. I'm in Canada. I'm in D.C.
Ah, in Canada. Wow. I love Canada. I have a lot of friends in Canada, in Toronto, in Montreal. I love Canada. Wonderful. Bonjour, le Canada.
Bonjour, Michel. I would love to reconnect. I would love to do a part two to this.
Yes.
If you're okay with that.
Contact me anytime, write to me anytime. And if you want to become teacher, certified in our way of meditation, if you want to come in a retreat, if you contact me anytime, we will take care of you, of course, of course.
Thank
we must
you.
Be kind, we must be kind. Thank you, Shai Rose. Thank you, my friend.
Thank you, Michelle. It was such a great pleasure. I really love your energy and being with you and talking to you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bless you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.